Welcome back to Arise News. You're watching The Morning Show. I'm Biola Alabi.
And I'm Victoria Pepple.
Nigeria's entertainment industry has grown in leaps and bounds in the last 20 years. And as it transits into a new growth phase, technology is expected to play a big role in the creative industry. But before we begin our discussion with our guests, let's take a quick look at their seminar titled Tech Meets Entertainment.
Structured entertainment continues to play a key role in the lifestyle of Nigerians. Music and comedy easily come to mind when it comes to entertainment in Nigeria. In recent times, however, reality television has added to that number. Personalities from across the entire entertainment landscape are doing all they can to make the best use of a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity here as technology meets entertainment in Lagos, Nigeria.
And so Tech Meets Entertainment Summit was an opportunity to bring top entertainers who are interested in new and creative ways to monetize, new and creative ways to do business and invest and get involved with startups, and as well as startups who are looking at the entertainment space to get involved with those entertainers, as well as startups who have great companies but just need a little bit more promotion. And that's what we're doing here today.
There are 250 software application innovators showcasing their efforts on this platform. They explain how the use of these apps can translate into practicable, real-time indicators as to which direction to push their enterprise.
You know, I think the way that we've seen the music business as well as some other businesses globally deconstruct, so you sort of have seen technology as disintermediated the middleman, sort of production houses. So we think the technology with entertainment, it shortens the gap between the producer of the content and the consumer of the content. And that's what technology allows you to do. So if anyone on the Maven platform decides that they're going to release content on a Friday, there's no reason why consumers shouldn't be able to receive that content on Friday afternoon after it's been released.
Startups, entrepreneurs can think about their distribution, so their marketing, their media relations, and how to smartly do that maybe if you don't have this much money. And what I talked about is that if you have a social media presence, that is essentially like your own little media company. So to really think about what you put out there, to make a good plan, to track the impact that you're having, and to take learnings from around the world. What are other people in this industry doing? You know, these days on the internet, you can basically read up on what's happening around the world and how can I apply this to my country, to my business.
Nigeria is on the verge of another general election, and among the innovations here is one that, if effectively deployed, is likely to enhance credibility and transparency in the exercise.
It's very secure. The technology they used to develop that is very secure. And when you look at the situation in Nigeria, we think that the election process needs to be reformed with the latest and greatest technology. So that's basically what inspired it. And we believe that combining technology and bringing it to our local experiences would help make the election process more transparent and also make it more secure and credible and also free.
Tech Meets Entertainment Summit has been an eye-opening experience, particularly for this young array of talent. How their interests are protected going forward will also be a function of how well the relationship between technology and entertainment in Nigeria keeps developing. Charles Ohaoku, Arise News, Lagos, Nigeria.
Here to discuss the takeaways from the summit is Chief Operating Officer of Ingressive, Sean Burrows, and co-founder of Ross and Shulga PLC, Gary J. Ross. Welcome to The Morning Show, Sean and Gary. How are you?
I'm doing fine. Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here.
Thank
you. Sean, before we ask you about the takeaways from the conference, can you just tell us a little bit about Ingressive and what you guys do?
Yes. To give you the short story, Ingressive is a market entry company. We basically connect global businesses and investment groups to opportunities in not only Nigeria, but Africa as a continent.
Mm. Okay. So how many countries are you guys operating in right now?
Right now, we're actually in 5 different countries. So okay. We're definitely in Nigeria, of course.
Yes.
Ghana, Kenya. We have some programs running in South Africa, and we're just dipping our toe into Rwanda.
Okay, fantastic. And Gary, tell us a little bit about what you guys do and how you guys are collaborating with Ingressive.
Yeah, sure. So I'm a corporate attorney in New York. I focus my practice on startups, particularly tech companies and also venture capital funds. Ingressive has a venture capital fund, has a $5 million venture capital fund, and we're the fund formation counsel for Ingressive. We've been working with them for about 2 years now.
Okay. So You guys came, you did technology meets entertainment.
Yes.
Tell us what motivated that and how that turned out.
What really motivated that was we have various connections in different communities. And one of the ones that stood out to us was the entertainers who were being approached by startups and business and startups and other people basically asking, like, can you be an advisor or can you invest in our company? And with them being in a completely different field outside of tech, them not knowing exactly what that means or what to do. So we took the opportunity to basically connect them to the tech community using this event.
So you're the connectivity between the two industries, bringing them together.
Well, they're naturally syncing together.
Sure.
And we need people to understand how that's happening. And also we want to create an environment where we can build something that reflects Africa.
All right, so let me ask you for a bit. Now, you being in the tech meets entertainment business and dipping your toe into it, how huge do you think the potential is?
Well, one thing that I really didn't know about, this is my first time in Nigeria. I came over to see what Ingressive is doing because I've like heard the names and whatnot, but to really like see on the ground. But one thing that my takeaway from the summit is, you know, a huge part of the Nigerian population, I think in the last segment you all were saying 190 million.
198 million.
198 yes. million, and yeah. half of that under the age of 25, I believe.
60% is under the age
yeah.
of 25.
And everyone having
yes.
a mobile phone.
Yes.
Almost
yes.
a lot of those people with mobile
yes.
phones, and you know, it's a huge market for the entertainment and media, media industry. So I see a lot of potential there and some people at the summit. I heard a lot of great ideas for keeping all those folks entertained.
So what were some of the key takeaways? I mean, what are some of the things that you guys are going to build on? What are some of the relationships you saw forming at the summit?
Some of the key takeaways, and actually something that I was very happy about, was how engaged the actual entertainers were.
Mm.
Not to just name drop or not to disrespect anybody, but not saying everybody's name, but even looking at Don Jazzy in particular, how he was there early before everybody else, very interested, kind of going around and asking everybody questions to kind of find out what's going on. So one of the major takeaways I see was, again, there's engagement, there's an interest. I think people are really seeing the fact that there's a lot of potential. If you look at what applications like YouTube have done for this media technology, if you look at what Facebook Live and different things have done, you've seen technology shift the power into the hands of people and giving anybody more opportunity to create and build their own brand. So again, we want to facilitate the process of, again, connecting these entertainers to the tech community and build some really innovative creations.
And all of this comes with investment. You talked about handling his investment. Now, how much do you think can come to Nigeria, especially with the session that you held?
Yeah, I think that there's that a lot of the world doesn't know about the tech community here in Nigeria, doesn't know about the fintech scene and the like. Mr. Adebu and I were talking before before he went on back in the waiting area, and he was telling me how much Nigerians love tech, and that's not something that the rest of the world always appreciates, at least in the United States. So one thing that I'm going to take away when I go back, I'm going to tell people about the fintech scene here in Nigeria and the fine people in it and all the innovative things.
So you telling them, how does that help the fintech industry in Nigeria?
Well, it might be education. I mean, it, a lot of investors are always looking for good opportunities. They're looking for scalable opportunities with the huge population here, and there's a lot of good resources here. I mean, one thing that I think of is the agri-tech industry, because you all have really good weather, unlike where I'm from, where, you know, it's 3 months of the year is blanketed with snow, you know, not a lot of agriculture is getting done during that time.
Sure.
So there's a lot of resources that you all are blessed here with that will be of use, not only in fintech, but in other places as well.
And Sean, you were saying?
And I think also you have to consider the fact that the news coming out of Africa is not always the most positive.
Sure.
So when you have opportunities like this to
So Gary's going to be an ambassador
stories.
Now.
Definitely.
So Gary,
I
want to call you an ambassador.
Yeah.
I think one of the things that has always, I'm someone that's in media, I've always felt that there's such a close link to media and technology.
Definitely.
And I wonder why that story doesn't really come out more. If you look at people like George Lucas had to build a whole technology infrastructure to be able to tell the stories he wanted to tell. If you look at James Cameron, James Cameron didn't do Avatar for many years because he felt that the technology to tell that story wasn't available. So he actually went into technology development. If you go all the way back to Walt Disney created animation as we know it today. So entertainment and technology, storytelling and technology have always gone hand in hand. And I feel like there's sort of been this world where people think that is isolated or they're separate, but they're actually much more integrated than people think they are. Did you feel that happening in the room when you were there the last couple of days at the summit?
I definitely did. Again, just like you said, people fail to realize that there is such a deep connection, because when you're looking at technology, the whole idea about technology is to make something convenient for the most amount of people as possible. And if you look at what an entertainer does, they're trying to reach and gain the attention of the most as most people as possible. Mm-hmm. So it's just a natural marriage between those two things. And as you said, the entertainment industry has in many ways pushed the technology. Because if you look at it, like for example, again, using YouTube as an example, when YouTube kind of blew up and a lot of people were kind of trying to get onto that platform, it kind of pushed development in other areas. So now you saw people who were now video transmission and sending videos back and forth. Now that pushed the advent of like 4G. Mm-hmm. Now we're jumping into 5G because now people want to be able to send bigger files, more larger pieces of data at a quicker pace.
And actually audio and visual is driving a lot of that development and technology into 5G. I mean, even satellite, I mean, audio visual developed the satellite business away, I mean, much more than actual communications, which I guess they're all communications in a way.
Exactly.
You've said YouTube quite a number of times. One of the things that happened last week was that YouTube sort of had these artists on the rise, and they actually were beaming pictures and videos of artists in Times Square. And one of the artists that was highlighted last week is Burna Boy, who is a Nigerian artist.
Exactly.
Those type of that type of exposure, that type of opportunity, how do you see that bringing African entertainment much more into, I mean, the center of, you know, entertainment? I mean, when you look at Times Square, there are millions and millions of people that go through that. How do you see more and more of those things happening? And then how do we start to get even a YouTube, like not YouTube as per se, but the actual applications also evolving from Africa, rather than just being consumers, actually being some of those developers?
That seems like a very deep question. So I would say,
I told you it's early in the morning, but we can. You know, we told you we weren't going to make this easy, but no. I mean, you know, what do you think?
Yeah. Well, I think if you look at the fact that in this world, people are not as different as we think. People are always going through similar things. Love is love, no matter where you go. So with that being said, when you have artists like Burna Boy, or even you have your WizKid, your David O's, and people who are crossing over, it wasn't the fact that we don't have artists or that we're capable or smart or talented. It's just the world wasn't able to see them. The world wasn't able to have access to them. So now again,
and
like
almost
saying,
mainstream in the same way. I mean, YouTube really can mainstream you in a way that maybe Fela didn't have that opportunity before.
Exactly. You're basically answering the question for me.
Yeah, so it's just trying to.
So again, it's like you said, it's pushing technology, it's pushing these artists to the forefront. I don't remember hearing a lot of artists when I was maybe like 5 or 10 years ago, I wasn't hearing a lot of activity. But again, now you're seeing more collaborations between people, because now with the addition of this technology now, Africa is becoming more of a viable market. Now you have U.S. artists who want to break into this, because if you're playing the long-term game, you understand that, again, you have 60% of the population here that is under a certain age, and these are the ones that are actually connecting to technology and have a more intimate relationship. So if you're a Jay-Z or if you're a whoever, and you want to, again, have a longer career or a bigger market, then you definitely want to connect into places like these. And technology today is setting the stage to allow not only artists here to go there, but also American artists and UK artists to actually come here as well.
How about venture funds? How do we create more type of funds that can actually explore more of these type of collaborations, but also smaller funds? I mean, I think sometimes, you know, I mean, how do you set up smaller funds that can actually be more experimental, and so that investors actually sort of that gestation period is also nurtured
Yeah, I think through the same things that you all are talking about, getting out in the media and the like. I mean, Ingressive's fund is an early stage fund, so they get in when startups really need the money. You know, they're not
angel.
You know, maybe right after the angel phase. I think of that fund. But using the media to get the word out to the rest of the world about the exciting happenings in Nigeria. You know, in the media, I don't see a lot of VC funds that are focused on media and entertainment. You know, most of the time they want to invest in manufacturing companies or tech companies and the like, particularly those with kind of hard assets. Mm-hmm. Tech companies don't always have that, but just kind of getting the word out about what's happening in Nigeria is only going to be a positive and increase positive awareness of the of the country around the world.
Now, during the session, did you get a sense of the legal aspects of the entertainment industry in Nigeria being handled properly? Because that is still a growing area when it comes to entertainment in Nigeria. So you've been there talking about tech meets entertainment, and of course, there's a legal aspect. What do you think Nigeria needs to know about that?
Yeah, I got a lot of questions about intellectual property, and I'm not an intellectual property attorney, but I got lots of questions about patents and the like, and people wondering about where to protect it. Yesterday, I was speaking at a startup event, and a lot of the questions were about they were afraid to have a mentor because it was a group of entrepreneurs, and they're like, you know, I'm afraid to have a mentor because they might steal my idea. So evidently, there's been some instances of intellectual property theft.
I feel like there is a bit of, there's more of an exaggeration of it rather than a reality of it.
Yeah.
I mean, that's one of the things I continue to notice. And I always tell people that really good ideas are actually harder to sell than you think. And so by the time, and also to a lot of people are thinking of the same thing around the same time, and then it almost becomes an implementation.
Well, they're still very afraid. Is that fear?
Yeah, I was telling them that it's better to be a first mover than spend a lot of time worrying about getting some expensive patent or something like that.
Yes.
Just try to be the first there. So, I mean, in terms of like, you know, my focus is on investing and the like, and you know, it seems to me the securities laws here, the laws around investing and the like, need to be a little stronger. In most of the rest of the world, you have to be an accredited investor or a qualified investor in order to invest, and here it seems everyone can invest, and you don't really want vulnerable people.
That's true, but there are some guidelines. I mean, there's some angel networks that do have very strict guidelines about who can be an investor as part of their network.
Who can join their network.
Who can join their network and your net worth, and also how much money you can invest. So there are some guidelines around that. Mm-hmm. And also in most legal agreements, the lawyers do put in there about investors. So if you have someone invest in your business, there is a clause in there about the risk of investing and all that stuff. So those are out there. It's just about people using them. And also, I think there's some tech companies that are trying to make those easier to use online.
But I want to try to cut out the lawyers.
That's what I was going to you. I have a question for you. As the world moves toward, I mean, one of the things you said was that people are very interested in investing in manufacturing and agriculture, and those are sort of the hard investments that people want to do. But as the world starts to move towards more of an idea society and a creative community, how do you get investors excited about that space?
Yeah, that can be tough. I think that it's a little harder for early stage companies to invest in, you know, someone who just has an idea. You know, I think that someone has to be a little further along. So in terms of how to get people excited about it, I guess, I mean, one takeaway that I've that I'm going to take with me from my visit here is just the enormous population in Nigeria. It's got some people, you know, some people at, you know, the top 1% or 2% or so. That there's some people who are really doing exciting things, like Andela. I was visiting Andela a couple of days ago, and I really liked their idea of using, you know, the great human resources here and then training people to offer development services around the world. So I think that there's a lot of people who would be interested in that.
Well, they're also funded by Facebook's venture fund or something like that.
Yeah, and so I think that that's, you know, with publicizing opportunities like that, I think that that's going to get other venture capital funds interested. So there's a lot of really success stories, so it's just getting the word out about these success stories in the country. I think that that's going to attract some capital. I don't know if that really answers the question, but
that's fine. I mean, I think that it's really, once again, it's about this idea and this sort of, one of the things that people have always invested in Nigeria has been about the commodities and the things under the ground. But with this booming population, with 60% of your population under the age of 25, the median age in Nigeria is 18, you have to start to invest in the people. That's really, at the end of the day, your investment has to move from here to here.
Right.
And so how do you sort of get a collection of people, investors, to say, look, we're going to start to incubate idea labs, we're going to start to incubate technology labs, we're going to start to incubate these places where the next new ideas are going to come from that are going to solve problems not only in Nigeria but across Africa, because those problems are quite similar.
I think it's going to go hand in hand with training. Mm-hmm. You know, training and education, train people for solving real problems. Cross-border payments, mm-hmm. I think, is a really exciting area in Nigerian mm-hmm. fintech. Evidently, PayPal, there's some issues mm-hmm. with receiving money through PayPal. Cross-border, training people. And the VC fund, maybe they won't invest, the first day a potential entrepreneur is going to school or whatnot or entering some program, but at the end of it, after a certain period of training, then it might be an attractive opportunity. I actually represent a company in New York that's founded by two Nigerian Americans, and they're trying to solve the cross-border payments issue. So I see that as another area.
Very good, very exciting.
Let's talk about something. Go ahead. All right, since it's Tech Meets Entertainment, and of course solutions were preferred, when it comes to the tech space, what do you think the entertainment industry needs right now? What do you think developers should be looking to create?
Again, that's actually one of the main things that kept coming up was like piracy. And also being able to track where the music's being played and being able to get a better idea of what the actual reach of these artists are. One of the perfect examples that I saw was, do you all remember Azonto?
Yes, when Dance Craze came out and it was going crazy here.
Of course, I believe it started in Ghana or Nigeria, mm-hmm. wherever that one was, but they were doing this dance and playing this music as far as Japan.
Yes.
Were these
yes.
artists getting any type of kickback, royalties, any type of royalties, any type of payments or anything from that? Mm-hmm. We need more structure around that industry. We need more help to basically maximize the impact of what these artists are doing. Mm-hmm. And I think that's some of the things that we were trying to
address. Where does the structure come from? Does that come from the government? Does that come from the entertainment industry? Or does tech help?
I think it has to come from the tech.
The industry.
From what I've seen, the government cannot answer all. It can't do everything. The government has to, in many ways, be a reflection of what the people are trying to do, a reflection of the direction that the people are trying to go in and support them mm-hmm. in that way. So if the people aren't keyed into a direction or keyed in or, doing these type of things, it makes it very difficult.
I mean, there are quite a number of collecting agencies in Nigeria. There are two major collecting agencies for music, and they've done a very good job in representing artists. But once again, that came from the artist. Mm-hmm. The artists usually manage these collecting agencies, and then the one thing you want is, and what the government can do, is rule of law. And so once laws are clear, then these collecting bodies then are working in an enabling environment. But where there's no, where people don't feel that their voices will be heard, that's when you're sort of always constantly leaning on the government. Mm-hmm. So there are a number of collecting agencies. In the 10 years that I've been very involved in the entertainment industry, I've seen a huge shift in actually these collecting agencies. And so some of them are not as far-reaching mm-hmm. in places like Japan and all that stuff, but they're Definitely. Part of a global body, mm-hmm. and that is well-respected if you're in the publishing of music rights and Definitely. Publishing place.
And they're called collection agencies?
They're called collecting bodies.
Collecting
so they're
bodies.
Like in places okay. like America, it's called ASCAP. Mm-hmm. So
oh,
they're,
yeah, sure.
so it's a publishing
yes.
and collecting yes. body.
Yeah.
In Nigeria, we have COSON, and they're basically, so they try to collect royalties, and they
oh,
actually,
okay.
And so you have to pay them to use music and mm-hmm. in anything you do. So if you were to look at Nollywood, 20 years ago, 15 years ago, people
That's
were
That's another takeaway from this trip.
Yes.
I know what Nollywood is now.
Yes.
I did not know that before.
See?
Before Wednesday.
So if you were using music in your films mm-hmm. 20, 15 years ago, nothing happened. But in the last 12 years, the collecting bodies have been very aggressive in going after them. People have been paying for music rights, and I think that's really changed that scene. Mm-hmm. The issue of piracy, though, since you brought that up, you said piracy came up. What are some of the themes that you have seen globally curb piracy, especially when we look at places like China that had a huge issue of piracy? Mm-hmm. What are the things that can be done to sort of start to curb the issue of piracy from a technical perspective and even from collaboration?
I'm thinking very deeply about this, and I would love to give you an answer. If I had the answer to that, I think I'd be in a very good place right now.
But what type of conversations did you see people having around piracy at the summit?
Well, that's the thing. We're all kind of scratching our heads, like, what can
very
we do?
Good.
How can
well,
we
that's
stop
good.
This
it's a problem
from happening?
There's
exactly.
also some because conversation in the industry that artists kind of encourage this piracy, because this is it. It's like a business move. The pirates put you out there. You have a good song, they put your CDs out there. So does it have to do with educating these artists and saying there could be a better way to being on the streets, every street corner, other than giving the pirates the license to put out your music?
I think what you have in some cases is a situation where people are kind of just, I can't control it, so let me kind of be the source of the leak.
That happens after they become big. But while they're looking...
Of course, you have a history of people like the mixtape. I remember was coming out with a mixtape and different things like that, which it makes sense. But again, it's just coming back to the fact that there's a big difference between I'm promoting and pushing out free music and trying to do radio interviews and different things, and then coming from a point of view of I have made a collection, a piece of art, in my own opinion, if somebody's creating something, how do you control how that goes? And you've kind of seen people going from CDs to the digital to trying to sell things on Apple and different things like that, to the point where now, which is part of the reason why the Tech Meets Entertainment Summit makes sense, is because it's very difficult to control. Once you make that music and you have to send it to somebody, or you make that video or that movie and you have to send it to somebody, It's out in the air.
So let me throw in one more question. So far, right now, when you're pushing out Nigerian entertainment to the world via tech, how well has that done?
From my opinion, from what I've seen, it's gone well. But again, we need to find a way to kind of monetize what they're doing. With the size of Nigeria by itself, it's already one of the trendsetters in Africa. And it's going beyond the borders, of course. We have a lot of our artists doing shows in the UK, shows in the US, and different things like that. With all these different artists having influencing how music is coming about, influencing sounds and different things like that, and sharing it, music that's coming out here, like if you look again, you're WizKid, or you're like even like Runtown, you have Mr. Easy, they're making music that if you were to hear it in a club in the U.S., you would say, like, okay, this is something.
So they are played in the U.S.
Exactly,
and other places.
Exactly. So, you know, there's that whole type of dynamic going. But again, it's how do you monetize their skill sets now that you've gotten the word out, now that you've shared the music? Because again, before, artists were making money selling their music. But now it's a situation where now most of the money is coming, especially in Nigeria, a lot of the money is coming from we're doing shows.
Yeah.
And basically, we're being sponsored by primarily
brands
telcos
and
different things like that. So now that you have all the eyes in the world looking at you, now that you have this influence in the market, what do you do with it? How do you turn these eyes looking at you into money? And that's basically what we were trying to tell them. We're telling them that.
Yeah, let me sneak in one more question.
Oh, please.
Now, in this monetizing idea we're talking about, the artist doesn't benefit alone. So tell us, how many other people get to benefit when entertainment makes money through tech?
I think in regards to tech, everybody has a part to play in it. There's nobody that is outside the realm of technology. So when it comes down to it, it's everybody, from the person who is basically making the application themselves. Again, if you're a successful artist, you manage to use technology to spread the word about your music and get people interested. Now you're going to need a lawyer. You're going to need a tax accountant. You're going to need Gary to come here
and
different things like that. So it's one of those things.
It's an ecosystem you're creating.
Exactly. And that's one of the words we use very often, tech ecosystem. We are, even as Ingressive, we call ourselves ecosystem architects. So if you kind of look what we're doing, what we do focus on tech, and we're bringing in companies like GitHub, we're bringing in companies like Figma and different things like that, and they're actually helping us build this Tech Meets Entertainment Summit. They're actually playing a part into it too, even though they have nothing to do with music, they have nothing to do with movies.
So what's next for your, what's next for tech, what's next for Ingressive, what's next for your summit?
What's next for Ingressive is we want to continue to build the capacity. I think, again, there's a narrative that we need to tell, there's a story that we need to tell, that it's not all Ebola and poverty. There's a lot of amazing things going on here. And once we start telling people, once we have people like Gary going back and inviting people to come back, it makes this more viable for investment.
As part of your ecosystem, you also do tech trips or
Tour of Tech.
Tour of Tech. Okay.
Yes, Gary's actually here for Tour of Tech.
Okay, that's, right. That's why you're here. Okay. So tell our audiences at home before you guys go what Tour of Tech is, and tell us about your experience on Tour of Tech.
Yeah, it's been wonderful. Like I said, I got to meet the people at Indela and tour that. Yes. I got to see the summit. I got to talk to a room full of entrepreneurs. So it's been really great. It's been an exciting way to see the country, and I look forward to keeping in touch with people
and listening to the music and watching the movies.
That's right. Yeah, Baller Boy.
Okay. Not
Baller Boy now,
okay.
But fly back.
He's now a Brenner Boy fan.
That's right. Okay. Yeah. I fly back to New York tonight, and I'm hoping maybe Ingresso will have me in the future.
Definitely, you're always welcome. And again, Tour of Tech primarily is to show people opportunities that are here.
Well, to convert Gary into ambassadors.
That's definitely right.
I guess it doesn't even feel like a conversion. Yeah. It's not like we were changing something from one thing. It's just kind of opening your eyes.
Sure.
Like just showing like, here, this is here, turning the light onto it and showing these opportunities.
Yeah, so I knew Ingresso was doing exciting things, and it's great to see it with my own eyes here.
Yeah.
Definitely. And it's not just showing them, taking them to a bunch of startups, a bunch of conferences. It's a curated experience where we kind of show them not only things on the ground as far as tech, but we went to an amazing boxing match.
Oh, that's right.
Look at you. You had so much fun. You're already forgetting.
Yeah.
Fantastic.
Yeah, it was wonderful.
So it's just all these things. So, like, when we want to get Gary to invest, Gary's going to not only know what the tech scene looks like, but he's going to have a feel for the culture of the place, the people that he's investing in as well. Mm-hmm. And it just makes it more impactful and more meaningful. Mm-hmm. And maybe I'm putting words in your mouth. But that's what we try to achieve.
Yeah. Fantastic. It's been great having you both on. I hope you all come back. And I hope you come back to Nigeria.
Yes, awesome.
Thank you, Sean.
Thank you for being here.
We're going on a short break now. When we come back, multimedia journalist and producer at BBC Africa, Yemisi Adigoke, will be joining us to review all the top newspaper headlines from across Nigeria. Stay with us.